Did you know 44 to 68% of people's waking hours are spent listening to music, and over 90% of people listen to music on a daily basis? Music while you're commuting, music while you're working, music while you're exercising, music while you're shopping, music in any of the movies or shows that you watch, music in any of the videos that you watch. Music is everywhere and listened to almost all the time. Have you ever thought of what all this music actually does to you? Well, as a person who has listened to music before and listens to music and has considered the question of what does music do to me, I want to share my firsthand experience on the negatives of music, the research I've done on the negative effects, as well as scientifically backed ways to use music in a positive way and ways that I've actually implemented it myself. But before that, what is music? At its most basic form, I think music is just a nicely arranged collection of sounds. And more or less universally nice collection of sounds, because almost all humans like it no matter the language. And also there's been some tests on animals with music, and it seems that animals also like music. Even plants like music, which is interesting. So music is nice, and music has the ability to change your state of mind, because you can think of like, oh, there's sad music, or there's happy music, or there's like hype music. Has the ability to change your mind in some way, shift your emotions. And all these things sound good. So what really could be the problem? How can music really be bad, or how did I find that music was bad? Well, my first encounter with it, you know, you have to write a lot of different papers in school, or even now when I'm typing like an email or something, you have to think, because when you're writing, you're essentially putting your thoughts onto a page. So in order to write well is to basically have clear thoughts, and then that's why you can put them onto a page. But then a lot of times when I worked, or at least back all the way back in school, when I was writing my papers, I would a lot of the times listen to music, because you know music sounds good. I listen to music quite a bit. But every time I was writing the papers or writing my emails nowadays, I tended to just turn off my music. It was almost like it was something like it was a little bit annoying to me, or it felt like that it was blocking my thoughts in some way, that I couldn't quite think 100% clearly to be able to write what I wanted to when I was listening to the music. And maybe you've encountered some of this before. And also within libraries, of course, they tell you to be quiet because you know you're reading, so you sort of have that like internal thought in your mind, like the voice in your head, like when you read something or when you write something. Well, where the part where music comes in is, see, I was listening, say you're listening to music when you read, you're listening to music when you write, as I mentioned. And for all the things that I just mentioned, so like reading or writing or just thinking in general, you have your internal dialogue, which is essentially your thoughts. But as I mentioned previously, and what music is something that can change your state of mind, which means when you listen to music while you're thinking or while you're reading, anything that has internal dialogue, listening to that music essentially drowns out your internal dialogue. So now there's two dialogues in your mind that is almost like fighting for attention, which inherently would decrease your ability to think, because there's another like essentially voice in your mind, and then would decrease your ability to read, of course, like, you know, there's another voice in your mind distracting. And depending on the music that you're listening to, if it has words like some spoken language that you actually understand, it enhance the effect of drowning out your internal dialogue, which will affect your ability to think clearly. So that is the first negative. And this was also mentioned in a video podcast that Andrew Huberman did, a neuroscientist, that if you don't know who he is. So it is scientific based as well. And he even goes further to mention that a study that I was done that was comparing people who listen to music or even white noise or brown noise, and then people that are working in silence. The people that worked in silence always outperformed even the people that were working in white noise or brown noise or listening to music, no matter what. They might not have felt like they were more productive, but they always were. And the second negative that I noticed was whenever I exercise or even work, like writing or just like crunching away on Excel, anything, or some sort of schoolwork, I would listen to music. Because, you know, of course, like doing this work or exercising is sort of like a little bit like a mindless thing, not really very exciting. So the music is something nice to listen to while you're doing that. and sort of makes a boring thing less boring. Or at least that's what I thought. But if you think about what the music is fundamentally doing, and you forget about the internal dialogue stuff that I just mentioned, music, it sounds nice, so it increases the dopamine, gives you a little hit of dopamine while you're listening to that music. And that, of course, that's why it gives you a little bit extra energy to do whatever like boring task that you're doing. But that also means if you're constantly listening to the music all the time while you're doing whatever task that you're doing, you constantly sort of need that dopamine to do whatever task that you are doing. And then without it, it'll be like super, super boring. You almost become dependent on that music, sort of addicted to that music, because you're always expecting like, oh, I'm going to get this music, this reward when I ever do this boring task. So you start to become reliant and expect that music, which negatively affects you, because now when you listen to the music, whenever you're doing the work, it's not going to be that impactful. It's just going to be like, oh, I'm just doing work eventually. And then when you don't have that music, you're going to barely be able to do the work and sort of less productive and feel like garbage, because now you don't have that music that's giving you that dopamine boost. So now you're like at a low. Again, also backed by Andrew Huberman. And another good example, you can think of it like eating the same food over and over again. Or like if there was a really great song, like the super great song, and you listen to it like every day on loop for 3 days straight. In the beginning, when you first listen to that song, oh, it was so great, right? And like you can like feel the state change in your mind, and you're like, oh, well, this is really good. But then after you, like the second day, the third day, you're listening to the same song on loop, it starts to lose its effect. And that's the same thing that happens when you constantly listen to music while you're doing your whatever work. So it starts to lose its effect, and you start to lose your engagement with whatever activity that you're doing with the music. And the third thing, so there was a book that I read before called Influence, The Psychology of Persuasion. And in that book, there was a story that I distinctly remember about a Chinese concentration camp. Or I don't know if you want to call it a concentration camp. It was like about a Chinese brainwashing camp, a communist brainwashing camp. They would have their like captured people. I don't know. I think they're Americans like during some war. I don't remember exactly. But then whenever the soldiers wanted to write home to their families, because, you know, of course, they're captured, if they want to write a letter to their family, they always force them like, hey, you can write a letter to your family, but you also have to add this little communist thing here. And of course, they wanted to send a letter to their family. So they always like, oh, fine, I'll write this little communist thing in here. And then they send off the letter. Every single time they wanted to send a letter, they had them write that communist pro note in there every single time. And then made that communist note increasingly more like severely communist. And eventually, these people that were captured and writing these notes to their families, they sent them home. And then once those people got home, they were like full-on communists. They were like preaching communists really hardcore. And you might wonder why that is. It's because there's actually a principle in persuasion or influence that, or I guess suppose this is more of a psychology thing, is that you want to be consistent of what you've said in the past or what you've supported in the past, which means by constantly making these concessions and subtly agreeing to all these communist things that these prisoners constantly agreeing to these communist beliefs because they wanted to write letters to their families. It seems harmless at the time, but by constantly conceding, they become more and more like essentially agreeing with the communism. And then now that they're set free because they're fully communist brainwashed and they've agreed to so many communist stuff already, they start to think like a communist and to be consistent with their like all the communist things that they've said before. Like now they're basically communists. But what does this have to do with the music? You hear all those people like listening to music that has like very bad messaging, like, oh, like kill bitches, fuck bitches, steal whatever money, all these bad messages in the music. And people are pumping this stuff in their ears 24/7. And yes, this music might have like a good beat or whatever, but the thing is, you're still pumping basically trash into your ears. Or a lot of people are pumping trash into their ears, which of course, is drowning out their internal dialogue in some way. And then by listening to the music, you're essentially inherently agreeing to whatever the music is saying. So if the music is saying like, oh, steal stuff, or like kill people, or do drugs, in your mind, you're agreeing to that concept. Maybe it's not as severe as totally getting brainwashed, but you'll slowly, your mind will slowly change to essentially accept those things that are being said. And if those things happen to be negative, then that, of course, is another negative of music. But it could also be a positive, because it is, of course, changing your state of mind. If it just so happens that that music is giving a negative message, then it'll transfer your mind for the negative. But you might also think, okay, well, could it transfer your mind for the positive? And I'd say yes, it can. And maybe if you thought about it a little bit already, you can sort of flip these negative things into positives, depending on how you use the music. And all the positive things that I'm about to talk to is also backed by Andrew Huberman. And of course, if you want to listen to his video, you can do that as he goes into more details. But I'm going to outline it in the ways that I have seen it personally to hopefully add some value. But the very, very, very basic thing of how to listen to music in a positive way from all the research that I've heard is, I think there's basically two ways to listen to music. One is the most common way, and then the other maybe is actually common as well. But there's two ways. You can either listen to music all the time, and so like, oh, you're listening to music while you work, listen to music like while you're driving, whatever. And that's quite common. Music is everywhere and people listen to it like most of their life. And then another way to listen to music is you legitimately like have a music listening session, like you putting your headphones on and sitting there like closing your eyes and listening to music and just purely focusing on the music. So you can listen to music while you're doing something, or you can listen to music and actually listen to the music. Those are the two ways. And if you think about the negatives that I mentioned, you might think, or you might already sort of understand, like, oh, you know, listening to the music while you're doing something, it might not be that great. And then just listening to music on its own, like, I mean, is that really great? Or could it be? I suppose it could. But you're essentially ruling out listening to music while you're doing something. Like, unless you're maybe out and you're walking or something, that's probably fine. So what's left is listening to music and actually listening to it. Just listening. Fully focused on the music. How can you use that in a positive way? Or could it be positive? Or is music just garbage? So for the first positive, I haven't experienced this myself, or haven't really had a situation where I really tested it myself. But I'm sure if you've heard of like people going through some hard times, like somebody died, or like, I don't know, their pet died, or they're sort of a breakup or something like that, something negatively emotioned. And then those people like go into like a spiral of listening to really sad music or something like that. And you might think like, okay, that might actually be like a bad thing, right? Because like you're already sad, and then you're pumping in music into your ears, which has a sad state into it. So you're like sort of amplifying your sad state in your mind, because you're putting like, you have your internal dialogue that's already sad, and then you put in another dialogue that's also sad. So you're not like double sad in your mind, right? So on one hand, you could be thinking like, oh, this might actually be bad, right? Because you have like extra sad in there. But on the other hand, which is actually the reality, apparently, based on what Andrew Huberman mentioned, is since you're actually amplifying those emotions, you're amplifying the sad, or you're amplifying whatever negative emotions, it actually helps you get over those negative feelings. Because say, for example, you have like a set amount of sadness. Since you're now amplifying it, you like shorten the time frame. You're like, oh, you're like extra sad now, but you get over it faster. So those people that are listening to sad music while they have some sort of negative thing going on might actually have something going on there. So that is the first positive way to use music, is to amplify an emotion to potentially get over something negative. And the second way, and this is one that I've used quite often since I learned about the different ways to use music, and I've tested it on myself. So say I'm working, I'm going through my day, I'm working, you know, I have like a pretty good working session, pretty productive, just in complete silence for like an hour, maybe 2 hours, or like an hour and a half, something like that. And my brain's starting to get a little tired, but I had a good productive session. Then I actually stop, and I might like get up and get a drink or whatever, but I also sometimes just sit there for like 10, 15 minutes and listen to some good music. And if that music is, you know, that music sounds good, so it's like a reward to my brain. And sometimes, you know, I might work throughout the whole day, and then, you know, like I spend like an hour and a half, 2 hours, and I'll just skip the music, it doesn't really matter. And out of the other times, of course, I do listen to music, and oh, that's like, it sounds good, right? It's a good thing. So what's going on there is I'm basically using the music as a reward for the work. And then since sometimes I listen to the music and sometimes I don't listen to the music, that reward stays consistent. And also, since I'm listening into isolation, I don't interrupt my work and able to keep my thinking well without the anything being interrupted or being overstimulated. And I also get the change of mind boost my productivity later in the day or my next working session by maybe changing my mind a little bit in a positive fashion. Say if I listen to really good, nice music, then it's like, ooh, you know, I feel nice, and it helps me push through to the following work. And as you can see, some of this stuff is like, is all related, and all related to the different negatives. And the third way is another thing that I've tested myself. So I exercise 3 times per week. And I generally exercise at the same time every single week. So I exercise during the evening, sometime after dinner, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. And every time I exercise in silence because, of course, because of the negative music, I don't want to like drown out my focus or anything like that. And I also don't want to overstimulate to keep that exercise like engaging. But what I started to do is before the exercise, I would listen to some really hype music, and then I go and do the exercise, and I'm like, oh, I'm you know, I still sort of got that mindset instilled into my mind and able to do my exercise more effectively, or like maybe get a little bit more out of the different exercises that I'm doing. What's really happening is, since the music has the ability to change your state of mind and also give you a dopamine boost, if you listen to that music before a task, what you're doing, like in my exercise example, or what I've done, is I listen to the music and I changed my state of mind into like a hype state of mind. So then when I actually do the exercise, that state of mind stays there and I'm able to do the exercise with a higher performance. And since I'm not listening to the music while I'm doing the exercise, I'm not overstimulated. So what it really comes down to is that the two ways to listen to music while you're doing something, and just listen to the music and only listen to the music. All the three positive ways that I mentioned points to listening to the music on its own. And then you can utilize the three things that I mentioned to get specific positive outcomes from the music and have a positive effect on your brain. And if you're interested in pushing your mind even further, maybe stopping yourself from listening to music in a negative way, you can watch this video here that I made on my subtle method of making and breaking habits.